After studying this module, you shall be able to know about the forensic anthropology. You will be able to learn about the scope and importance of forensic anthropology. Introduction. During the past two decades, the discipline of forensic anthropology have received recognition from their potential contribution to crime scene and death investigations. During the 1980s, there was a growing emphasis by forensic anthropologists on the use of proper archaeological field methods when recovering and excavating human remains from forensic context. Broadly defined, anthropology is the study of humans. The word anthropology derives from Greek anthros, that means man, and logos, that means the study of. Anthropologists use a holistic or biocultural approach, that is a combination of cultural studies and biology, to understand the many facts of human behavior, both past and present. Anthropology is commonly divided into four areas of study, including the cultural anthropology, archaeology, linguistics, and physical biology, that is physical anthropology. Cultural anthropology deals with many aspects of human society, including but not limited to social structure, behavior, beliefs, and ways of life. Cultural anthropologists mostly work with living societies, whereas archaeology is a study of past societies through material remains such as pottery, stone tools, art, and architecture. Linguistics deals with the evolution of languages and relationship between languages and societies. In most cases, linguistics is an important aspect of the other areas of anthropology. Physical or biological anthropology deals with the physical and biological aspects of primate order and includes studies of humans, past and present, and non-human primates, such as the chimpanzees, gorillas, monkeys. Some of the more specialized areas covered by physical anthropology are primatology, that is the scientific study of non-human primates, example apes, monkeys, and promiscens, including their anatomy, behavior, and ecology. Next we have paleoanthropology, that is the study of ancient hominids through the fossil records, is an important to reconstruct the evolution and behavior of humans. Then we have the human biology, that is the study of modern human variation and adaptation. Next is human growth and development, the study of how humans develop from conception of old. Next is nutrition, the study of human nutrition and its effects on human development, both from modern and evolutionary perspective. Then we have the genetics, that is the study of human DNA from evolutionary perspective. And last one we have the osteology, which is the study of human skeleton including anatomy, demographics, and pathology. So where do forensic anthropology and forensic archaeology fit into all this? By definition, forensic anthropology is the application of physical anthropological theory and methods to answer questions posed to a legal sphere. Anyone interested in becoming a forensic anthropologist must first become a physical anthropologist who specializes in human osteology or human skeletal biology. Osteological analysis can yield clues as to how individuals might have lived, how old they were when they died, whether they were female or male, their state of health, like they are healthy or diseased, and the types of trauma they may have experienced related to the events such as warfare, occupation, and death. Once the skill of human osteology are mastered, it becomes possible to apply the methods and techniques of analyzing skeletal remains to cases of legal importance. When forensic anthropologists apply methods to skeletal analysis to cases of unidentified modern remains, they are using osteology in a legal context. Now, let us see the history of forensic anthropologists. The history of forensic anthropologists extends back to 19th century, when entomologists and physical anthropologists were occasionally asked to provide their assistance in human identification. In 1935, Mathieu Orfil, French expert of forensic medicine, published a textbook containing data on measurements of arms, bones, and their sex difference. E. Rollet was the first who had elaborated the tables of our male and female stature reconstruction from bone length. Bertillon proposed an anthropometric system of adult individuals for personal identification that relied on taking of the measurements for bony parts, including measurements of human ear, that was later abandoned in favor of fingerprinting. In the period between the First and Second World Wars, numerous works dedicated to a particular aspect of forensic osteology were published. Some of them still are in use today on pubic symphysis. Now let us see analysis method. First is skeletal remains. The first phase of analysis begins with the skeletal inventory of the presence or absence of each element, as well as any duplication of element that might be present, indicating that there is more than one individual represent. Placing the remains in an anatomical order also allows case of completion of skeletal inventory, which is critical to documenting and maintaining the chain of custody. This inventory should also indicate fragmentary bones, yet these should not be expressed numerically, as these may subsequently disintegrate into smaller fragments and the number becomes problematic because the numbers changes. The inventory must also note the condition of the remains at the stage of the analysis, including a taphonomic assessment of post-mortem damage, example staining, carnivore or rodent ganoing, breakaging, root itching, etc. Likewise, standardizing views of the skeleton should be taken as well. Such photographs should include the following: the skeletal overview of individual anatomical order, the maxillary and mandibular dentation, all elements used to estimate the age of individual, all antemortem trauma of pathology, and all the premortem. Now we have the biological profile. The second phase of analysis is concerned with creating a basic biological profile of the individual skeleton, determining the sex, ancestry if relevant to the identification of individual for repatriation and for judicial needs, then age and stature during his life. It is not the intention to repeat what is widely understood about basic anthropological method, but to stress the issues of key concern in forensic application. Then we have the sex determination. Identification of a sex of an individual from a human skeletal remain is the first most important step, which is faced by both forensic expert and anthropologist. There are many possible conditions through which sex of an individual is determined, such as skull, pelvis and sternum. According to Krogman's rank, that is in 1978, of accuracy of sex determination using pelvis is gives 95%, whereas skull gives 90%, and when we have both pelvis and skull, the accuracy increases by 98% and the long bones gives around 80% of accuracy. In earlier days, the non-metrical method such as visual impression about the pattern of bone morphology is used for determination of sex from such skeletal remains, which entirely depends on ability and experience of the expert. And unless whole skeleton is available, it is almost important to assign sex with 100% certainty in all cases. Although the skeleton is an excellent material in living and non-living population for genetic, anthropological, odontological and forensic investigation, skull bone features vary from male to female, and differentiation is usually based on the male features that are typically more pronounced and marked than female features. The study of sexual dimorphism includes all the features related to reproductive role, notably the endocrine, that is the hormonal system, and physical, psychological and behavioral effects. It is also evident that in adults only sex hormones increases around the time of puberty, leading to secondary sexual characteristics. The basic difference between skeletons of male and female are based on evaluation of sexual dimorphism, which are size difference and functions related difference, such as female and have a unique pelvis characteristics, which are due to process of childbirth. And when we look into male skeleton, they appear as robust and massive. Now, let us see the role of anthropologist. Forensic anthropologist can help you recover and analyze human remains, particularly those that are decomposed or skeletonized in a rapid, efficient manner. The training of forensic anthropologists allows them to recover skeletons quickly. Besides rapid recovery, their training enables them to glean information from site that may be valuable in later analysis. Anthropologists can also help in reconstructing the previous events that are related to the deceased, as well as natural and intentional changes to the body and its surrounding at the place of discovery. Once they recovered, the forensic anthropologist can determine many of the biological characteristics of a skeleton that are needed to identify the deceased. Finally, the anthropologist will find any relevant clues on the bones and teeth that may relate to the cause of death. Perhaps the first question to be asked by the medico-legal officer is, how can a forensic anthropologist help me? To some extent, the answer is defined by the case and by specific training and experience of the forensic anthropologist. However, it is possible to outline the kinds of cases an anthropologist have been helpful. To make a gross generalization, there are four scenarios in human remains require complete examination. That is, first one is complete remains with no or minimal decomposition. Next is decomposing remains, then skeletonized remain, and the last is remains altered by extraordinary conditions. It may be fire, dismemberment, high impact trauma, or any of many natural or artificial methods. In each scenario, the goal is to determine the identity of a person and to reconstruct the events surrounding his or her death. The less complete and more disturbed the remains, the more likely that a forensic anthropologist can find should be called to assist in recovery and examination. Each of these scenarios can be divided into phases of activity. Traditionally, the forensic anthropology was primarily involved with the last phase, examination. However, it is probable that forensic anthropologists can aid in earlier phases such as the discovery and recovery phase. Discovery includes all the work done up to the point at which the actual remains or gravesite is found. The recovery phase includes the work of removing the remains to the laboratory facility. In the lab, the formal examination or the last phase begins. The forensic goal, regardless of the body condition or phase of investigatory activity, is to identify the remains and to determine the circumstances of unexplained death. Uncertainty measure biological characteristics such as the age, sex, race, or ethnicity and stratum are often the first pieces of data that help focus the investigation on specific group characteristics. Individual biological characteristics such as the pattern of dental restoration, evidence of previous trauma and medical condition, or unusual biological characteristics focuses the search within a specific sex, age, race, etc. Forensic anthropologists can identify and determine these characteristics, examining small structure on the skeleton and determining what they mean is the anthropologist's key contribution to the forensic investigation. For example, small changes at joints such as the knee, elbow may indicate to the anthropologist that the person has suffered a particular type of injury in the past. A small bump on a bone may indicate the site of well-healed fracture. An empty tooth socket might indicate either a tooth lost before the death or during the recovery. Evidence of healing separates the two. In summary, the forensic anthropologist can determine what on skeleton is normal or what is abnormal and which characteristics are of forensic significance and which are not. Just as important as biological characteristics of the remains is identifying the circumstances leading to the discovery of the remains and determining what has happened to the remains since death occurred. For example, whether or not the body was moved time since death, an indication of trauma that might have occurred before, at the time of, or after the death, or are all critical elements that our forensic anthropologist often can provide in forensic cases. Now, let us see the scope of forensic anthropology. The scope of forensic anthropology is extensive and is increasing every day. It includes the collection, preservation, and analysis of human skeletal remains for identification and reconstruction of events surrounding the death of an individual. Many killers are used to dumping the dead bodies of their victims in the remote sites, means that most often the police to have a skeletal remains to aid in their investigation. It is then left to the forensic anthropologist to use this flimsy evidence and shed some light on the cases or with the expertise. Now let us see, the forensic anthropologist is responsible for addressing a number of questions. Is that material bone? Is the bone of a human or non-human? What is the prevention of the remains? Are the remains of forensic significance? How many individuals are present? What is the ancestry of the individual? What is the sex of the individual? What is the age of the individual? What is the stature of the individual? Are there many individualizing characteristics? If there are evidence of trauma or pathology? Now, let us see the importance of forensic anthropology. First is determination of species. The bone should be sorted out into human or non-human bones. Then, determination of age. The appearance of union of centers of bone, the growth and certain other changes in bones and teeth helps the investigator in determining the age of the individual at the time of death. Then we have determination of sex. The adult skeleton has several morphological differences between the different sexes, which are utilized to determine the sex of the individual. Then we have determination of race. Bones have certain morphological characteristics which are confined to individual of a particular race. Based on these, the racial groups to which the individual bones can be arrived. Then we have the height. The height of individual can be calculated with reasonable accuracy by applying formulae to the length and individual bones, especially the long bones of limbs. Now, let us see the case report. The purpose of an anthropologist report should be stated clearly. The case report record physical observation on the remains, identifies important biological characteristics, identifies and differentiates changes in the remains due to natural and cultural forces, and provides the information in a meaningful and understandable form to the medico-legal officer in charge. As a part of the preliminary understanding between you and the forensic anthropologist, a report should form as agreed upon. The report is generated by the anthropologist after careful examination, research, and reflection. To a large extent, the complexity of the case will determine how long this process takes. The anthropologist's report should provide the most detailed and precise data that can be provided at the time. However, that does not mean that report cannot be modified if a statement is unclear, if the clue that lead a particular conclusion do not make sense to you. It is reasonable for you to ask for further classification. If additional technical tests are conducted, that information should be given to the anthropologist for consideration. Any new evidence may require a new look at anthropologist's finding. A question concerning reports, they need to be written, not verbal. It is always bad idea to press the anthropologist for detailed and positive determination during the recovery phase or initial parts of the examination phase. Speculation is dangerous for you and anthropologist. Although any investigator, including anthropologist, makes observation and may be mulling over various ideas while in the field, are not final result and may change once all the data has been reviewed. Although everyone wants the result as soon as possible, instead it costs time, efforts and credibility. The anthropologist's report should provide a synthesis determination of result which can be sustained by the data. In general, Each major biological characteristic should be identified. The anthropologist should state the conclusion as clearly and unequivocally as possible. At times, the medico-legal officer may ask the forensic anthropologist to address specific points of information such as the identifying the probable cause of trauma on remains or determining the time since death. The report should include a discussion of how each result has reached. However, a full discussion of techniques and reasoning behind the use of techniques over another may actually result. Additionally, the most useful reports are complete yet concise. The report should avoid conclusions that cannot be sustained within the anthropologist's sphere of knowledge. Anthropologists do not know anything, and their return comments should be limited to their expertise. You may damage your case any time you ask for accept statements from people who are willing to speak on subjects beyond their field. Now, let us summarize what we have learned in this module. Anthropology is commonly divided into four areas of study, including the cultural anthropology, archaeology, linguistic and physical, that is biological anthropology. Bertillon proposed an anthropometric system of adult individual for personal identification in 1885 that relied on the taking the measurements of bony parts, including the measurements of human ear, that was later abandoned in favor of fingerprint. As already told, anthropologists can also help in reconstructing previous events that are related to the deceased, as well as the natural and intentional changes to the body and its surrounding at the place of discovery. Ascertaining major biological characteristics such as age, sex, race, and stature are often the first piece of data that help focus the investigation on a specific group characteristics. The scope of forensic anthropology is extensive and is increasing every day. It includes the collection, preservation, and analysis of human skeletal remains for identification and reconstruction of events surrounding the death of an individual.